of the findings of fact, and the motion is approved.
Madam Chair, I have a question.
Yes, Mr. Lupa.
For the applicant. Steve, is there any implication with regard to the impact of the excavating for the utilities in the wetland areas, which would be either benefited by being done in the dry season as opposed to the wet season, or conversely require more precautions because it's being done in the dry season as opposed to the wet season in terms of the plants and the disturbance and vegetation? One way or another, does it make a difference?
It doesn't really make a difference given the type of wetlands that we have in there, and the corridors are fairly well defined, so it doesn't make a lot of difference in terms of timing of construction.
Thank you.
Madam Chair?
Yes, Mr.
The performance bond on this is in the form of a letter of credit, is that correct, to the planner?
Yes, which is being held by the town manager.
What abilities or legal right does the town have to draw down that letter of credit and simply complete the work?
We have a legal right to do that.
Okay. What would trigger, I guess, without going into depth, what would trigger our right to be able to draw
it? I don't have a copy of the most recent letter of credit.
My major concern is that, you know, we've been through this a lot, and I'm getting pretty sick and tired of having to deal with the same issue, and it seems to be the excuses don't even change that much from time to time, and then there comes a point when I think we simply go ahead and take care of business, whether it's Mr. Kennedy's property or not. This is going on 6 years, I think, 5 years anyway. And I guess I'm torn between the idea of holding a public hearing simply to hear what the neighbors have for suggestions on how we cure the issue, or number two, simply going making a recommendation to have the town cure the problem. I guess through the planner, is there any discussion regarding the feasibility of the town completing this work after drawing down the credit?
The typical procedure for calling a letter of credit is the action has to be initiated by the town manager. And I'm just looking, I have the previous letter of credit before this one. And if the town wants to call the letter of credit, they have to present the original letter of credit. They have to present a certificate, which is basically a letter that says that the borrower, in this case the applicant, has failed to complete construction within the time frame herein set forth to the standards of the town of Cape Elizabeth. And third, a written opinion from the town engineer that the applicant has failed to perform the work is enumerated in accordance with the standards of the town of Cape Elizabeth and the terms of the subdivision approval dated whatever date. Usually a letter of credit is the usual term for a letter of credit is 1 year. So my assumption is that the current letter of credit is good probably until June of next year. Do you have a copy of the current letter, Steve?
I do not. But Karen, do you have a copy?
Let me check. I don't think I do have a copy of the current one.
Just to be clear, when you talk about the current letter of credit, you're talking about the letter of credit that was posted to run with the amended subdivision plan, or the letter of credit that's in place for the prior approved subdivision, which if the board pulls a letter of credit would have to be the letter of credit you'd be pulling, which was not for the amended plan, but for the plan that's in place right now.
My understanding is the one I have was to cover phase 1B, and it was replaced with a new one because the dates were all old. So when I talk about the new letter of credit, I mean one that is current for this approval. But even if there hadn't been this approval, there probably would have been a new letter of credit anyway, because the dates on the old one were old. But this, like I said, I don't have the current one.
And we don't have any information about what the expiration date is.
Okay. regardless, I think it's, the issue is, has there been any discussion by the staff as to their willingness, the town staff, Public Works, to go in and complete the project, utilizing those funds? Has there been any discussion at all? Or are you able to say that?
No, I don't think so.
No?
No, I'm not able to say.
I don't know, I'm interested in other board members' feeling about whether we simply need to, I have absolutely no faith that the applicant will actually act this time any more than they have previously. It's my own opinion.
Any other board member?
We're just kind of caught. I mean, if we don't, if we call a credit, and the project just sits there as it's sitting right now, if we go along with, again, approving this thing, then we hope and pray again, maybe the butters and everybody will be satisfied. I don't know what the answer is. The credit letter is supposed to have some power, but it's just sitting there, and we're not using it. So why even bother with it? If we just, there's going to be something, some kind of meat in that letter of credit to make other developers get their job done because of that hanging over their head. And here, I'm embarrassed because I seconded, or I proposed that one. I said, well, I'm kind of new on the board, and let's get that thing done. But, you know, I looked at the faces of some other people on the board, and I guess they were just kind of wondering whether I was dreaming. And I guess I was. But I don't know what we do. I mean, there are butters here this evening, I'm sure. They're looking at us and saying, wow, I mean, where are we going with this thing now? And rightfully so. Well, if I was in a butter and I sat down there next to that pond that's a dumping ground for water, I'd be pretty angry. But yet, the applicant never shows. I don't even know who Peter Kennedy is or looks like. And maybe that's not important, but I certainly would like to meet him and just be able to eyeball him. But that, there's no manners there. And then he's out of the country, and then comes back 2 days after the 90 days. Other things more, apparently this isn't very important. This is just one of the things he can, you know, he'll just drag it on again. So I'm embarrassed, and I don't know what to say to the people here this evening. Thank you.
Excuse me. Can I address the board, please? Maybe I can clarify this issue somewhat. As far as...
Would you identify yourself for the record?
Yes, I'm Karen Walsh, and I work for Peter Kennedy. And I would like to say that I was fully responsible for the filing of the plan. Yes, Peter was out of the country, but it was my responsibility. Basically, what happened was I was under the impression that the plan was not to be recorded until the 24th. I picked it up from Steve's office on the 15th, and that's when Steve, I believe, picked it up from Maureen. We did not get the plan, the plat, back until then. So basically, we did not have a full 90 days, so to speak, to record. I believe what happened was it was in the attorney's, the letter of credit was being reviewed and was in the attorney's hands for quite some time. So therefore, we did not receive our signed plan back until the 15th. Yes, granted, we did have a whole week to record it, and I sat on it, and basically that was because I was under the assumption it was due back on the 24th. It was due to be recorded on the 24th, and I did record it, but it wasn't until the 22nd, which was 2 days after the actual deadline of the recording. Peter, when he came back, we actually thought we were recording it 2 days early, and we did go ahead and have our construction meeting, but that was on June 3rd. That was our pre-construction meeting. We fully intended to go forward with the project. I have the minutes from the meeting in front of me. We were very surprised when we heard that it was recorded late. I especially was surprised, and I do accept full responsibility.
Madam Chair, just one other thing. Is it customary for a developer or an applicant in this case to wait to the last day of something? Is that?
Well, I don't know that we can get into that, Mr. Carlson, but I guess what I'd like to suggest is that this board, I think, is quite clear on the requirements that the plan needs to be recorded within the 90-day period. There's absolutely no dispute about that. That's in the letter, that's both in the minutes of the meeting and also in the letter which the acting chair submitted to the developer, saying that that was indeed the case. With respect to what letters of credit are, generally, just to address a slightly earlier issue that you raised, the whole idea of having the applicant come before a planning board is to try to take what the applicant is interested in presenting, make sure that it is in accordance with what the town rules, regulations, and ordinances are, try to take into account what the concerns of the abutters are, if any, and then require, as part of a performance, require a performance guarantee as part of the town's, representing the town's concerns that give the developer an incentive to complete the project on time. I think what you are experiencing at this point is our level of frustration with the fact that the project has taken an inordinate amount of time, and I, for one, have expressed my absolute dismay on several occasions with the current state of the project, the way that the developer has not comported himself in accordance with the standards that would normally be required in earlier times, and frankly has given us very little or no indication that he can be relied on to complete what he says he's going to complete. And I guess I'm glad to hear that the other board members have the same kinds of concerns that I do with respect to this matter. Haven't heard from Mr. Wilcox particularly, and I don't know whether you have anything that you'd like to say at this point.
At this point, I would like to offer my thoughts on the matter. The plan, I can understand that there is frustration because it has not actually happened, but on the other hand, this is different, I think, from our last review of this application, because in this case, nothing was done. The applicant merely, let's say, look at it in a different light, the applicant merely did not proceed with the work. In this case, there has been no changes to the proposed work, and the applicant has merely decided to take a project off the shelf and go ahead with it, which I think would be to the would be a merely putting in place what the applicant had previously offered to do. In terms of looking at a performance bond process for this project, if the new performance bond is similar to the old performance bond, I think it would be hard to allege default or violation of town standards when the contractor hasn't even begun work. So I think that is something that sounds fairly, I'm not a town attorney, municipal attorney or anything, but it sounds kind of hard to prove default on an act that has not taken place. So from my perspective, I view this as merely the same application that we saw a few months ago, unfortunately coming back to us again, but I see no reason to review it in a different light.
I guess I would just like to respond to your comments about the performance bond as totally hampered by not having the language of the document before us, but the performance bond generally would have been posted in compliance with the original subdivision approval and would have had a termination date that would have presumably been in line with what the target date of the subdivision was. And the town would have had the right, presumably, to pull that performance bond some time ago. And has, because of the failure to complete the project on time, but I don't know that to be the case entirely. My understanding is that the town has been quite generous, frankly, in trying to work with the applicant to get the project completed. And there comes a time when the town might be encouraged to say, enough is enough is enough is enough, if you can't complete it within the time period that you indicated you could, then it's time for us to pull the bond completed and finish it up one way or the other. The neighbors should not have to be subject to an uninterrupted interruption of what their situation is. So I guess one of the things that occurs to me tonight is to find out whether there's any interest in holding a public hearing tonight. We have been discussing this among ourselves, and I think we always have the right to hold a public hearing. We certainly aren't required to do it in this case. And I don't know what the brothers of anybody else on the board are.
I guess in response to your question about the public hearing, have we noticed all about us potential public hearing tonight?
Fair question. We'll ask the town planner to tell us what she's done.
The notice read to interested residents in the area of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, and Hunts Point Road, the Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. I got the wrong notice.
Appreciate it.
It's in here. The Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board will hold a meeting on Tuesday, July 16, 1996, beginning at 7 p.m. to consider a request by Peter Kennedy, the Greater Portland Development Group, for reapproval of amendments to the Highland Subdivision located in the area of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channelview Road. The subdivision amendments were approved by the Planning Board on February 20, 1996. However, the approval expired when the applicant did not record the amended plan within 90 days. For more information or to review the plans, please contact the town planner.
So no mention of a possible public hearing.
Yeah, I think that falls short of, you know, appropriate notice. The other issue is a matter of time. We're approaching a triple witching hour to get another item in tonight. My own concern is that the twofold. My reason for questioning about the timing at the very beginning was not trying to say that we have a right to draw down. We were given assurance that it was. And I certainly voted in favor of that based on those assurances that the work was going to start at that time, is going to complete at that certain time. And the letter, which I noticed that I signed, I didn't even remember that I signed it, says very clearly, for the public, doesn't have a copy, it says the revised recording plat must be signed by the planning board and recorded within 90 days, which is May 20th, 1996. It's very difficult to come up with any other date than that one day. And that's the day that has to be done. My reason for questioning when these were going to be complete, we were assured that the work was going to be done at that time, they certainly would have thought about recording that plat before they began work. And we're talking back in April, probably a month and a half prior to the date that it became late, which indicates to me that there was no intention of starting at that time, which breaks the assurance that we were given to do the work. I guess based on that, I have the sense that we should recommend to the town manager that we take action on the performance bond and make those improvements. The legal question that I don't know is, if the plan is null and void, what authority does the town have to complete improvements to a plan that's null and void?
There is a legal subdivision that has been recorded, and if the town were to go ahead and complete improvements, it would be on the previously recorded plan. So it would be on the plan where the water line had not been moved out of the right-of-way and run up directly to Hunts Point Road.
I'd just like to say that the specific issue before us tonight is the particular application that's here. And if it is approved, then that's fine. The developer goes and does what he's got the right to do under the approval. If the approval is not granted, then the developer is faced with the existing situation, as I understand it, which is the approved subdivision as is, And if there is a further application the next month, or if there is further discussion with the town manager or whatever, that's not before us at this point. It's simply the specific motion that's here tonight.
Through the chair, if I could just address the board for a minute. I think one of the issues here is that my understanding is that Peter was in fact working with the bank and with the town manager to establish the letter of credit and the bond during that time period in April. And that what happened in April was that when that bond amount went back, then there was a loss of time when there was this issue about conflict of interest with Mr. Leahy's office being both the bank attorney and the town's attorney. It was, I think it should be clear to the board that Peter was making an effort to do something at that time. There was a construction meeting held in early June to try and move forward. The intent at that time was to begin construction and move forward. So I don't think there was any intent on Peter's part not to move forward with the subdivision. It was a question of moving forward in a timely manner. And I understand Mr. Edsel's concern about not meeting the time frame that was set before the board when we came before you, because that was what we had at the time, and we knew that was our time and construction schedule. But that did not foresee problems securing that bond.
Thank you, Mr. Board. Any other comments from the board? Motion?
Madam Chair?
Yes, Mr. Board.
I would like to offer the following motion.
Fair enough.
Findings of fact. One, Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group is requesting reapproval of amendments to the Highlands subdivision granted by the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board on February 20th, 1996. Two, the February 20th, 1996 approval is null and void because the recording plat was not recorded within 90 days of the approval as required in section 16-2-5 of the subdivision ordinance and specified in the approval letter. Three, all plans and materials submitted as part of the February 20th, 1996 approval are hereby incorporated into the current request for subdivision amendments. Four, the subdivision substantially complies with section 16-2-5 amendment to a previously approved subdivision. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the Highland subdivision located in the vicinity of Jordan Farm Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channelview Road be approved.
Thank you. Do I hear a second? I don't hear a second.
Oh, well.
Is there another motion?
Madam Chair, I think I'd like a little more discussion. We're faced with three issues. We can always go back and as we are usually, we can approve, deny,
or table.
Because it failed by lack of second to move the approval. Other options are to deny or to table. Tabling simply puts us off. We'd gain time for some legal counsel as to what we can actually do, or whether the town wants to go ahead and do that. We could also schedule a public hearing tonight with the tabling, which I think perhaps would gain some insight to the neighbors' opinions of, you know, they've been at this longer than we have. And then I think maybe 30 days is not going to push them over the edge, I guess. Or we can deny it puts us back only to the stage of back at the old subdivision approval. We still have that, and that's actually the approval that's in place right now to take action on. I guess I'm looking for consensus before we go forward. So we don't go through three or four different motions here. You know, are people looking to table us so we get the time to get public feedback for 30 days? legal counsel, staff's inclination to do the work themselves. Any comment?
Mr. Carlson?
The comment I have is, I'm looking for assurance that it will be done, you know, and I don't know how that can happen. Nothing seems to get it done. You know, if we go back and we deny it, then what's going to happen? I'm sure the applicant will then apply again for what he's got here, and we'll go through the public hearing. It'll be 3 or 4 months. In the meantime, the condition continues in the development. I'm almost to the point of saying I almost second it, because I thought, well, maybe we'll get it done. We'll get done this time. But I hesitated. So maybe if the motion is made again, I probably will second it with my tremendous trepidation, but maybe get the job done. Before we know it, we got winter, then we got the spring, and it continues on. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carlson. Mr. Moore, do you have any, or is it Wilcox?
Karen? Mm-hmm. Yes, just to address Mr. Carlson's concerns, I do want to say that I have been talking actively with several customers who are interested in building in the Highlands, and that I can tell you quite honestly that we do plan to proceed, and we are quite anxious to proceed with the subdivision. I do have the minutes of the pre-construction meeting, as I stated before. Our intent was to go forward. We did speak with our contractor and had every intention. I mean, I don't think that you can really compare this to, you know, times that we have come back to you in the past. This was, you know, purely a mistake. And although it was spelled out that it was due to be recorded on the 20th, mistakes do happen. And I made one, and it was recorded on the 22nd, and we were 2 days late. But we definitely do plan to proceed. Our contractor is ready. We have customers that are ready to buy in that subdivision.
Madam Chair, just one question. Do you have, Steve, do you have dates, new dates, when you're going to start things, or like we had the previous time?
Are you a brave man?
Well, I mean, I'm really...
as I said, I didn't think I'd be back here again on this project. I do not have definitive dates from Mr. Kennedy about stop and start dates. I can share with you incidental dates that I have from the contractor who spoke with me about stop and start of construction and timing out there. And all I can relay to you is what I've heard from R.E. Coleman, who has told me that this was on their schedule to begin work sometime in early August, and they thought they'd be out of there by the middle of September. And I said, I doubted that. It would probably be the end of September. That's why I recall that. That's the only information I can shed about construction schedule and timing. Karen, do you know specifically what the construction schedule is?
No, I mean, other than what was spelled out on these minutes, of course that's changed because we've been postponed on these minutes. So I would say that that's fairly accurate what Steve has just stated.
May I ask the applicant whether there would be... I'm sorry, I withdraw the question. I was going to ask you whether you consented to a tabling, but I don't think you need your request, your consent for the first 60 days. It doesn't appear that there is a groundswell for approval of the application at this point. The two possibilities that we have otherwise are to simply deny and leave it in limbo, or to table. In response to Mr. Edsel's question, and I guess I'm probably speaking as a member rather than as the chair at this point, it seems to me that it would be highly appropriate to table the application to the next meeting schedule a public hearing to take into account whatever concerns there may be from the abutters, confirm that no work has been done since February the 20th. I'd also like to suggest that we request a copy of the existing letter of credit, perhaps request the town manager's appearance at the next planning board meeting to explain why the performance bond has not been pulled to date, and simply, I think, on behalf of the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, have a full understanding of why the project has gotten to this point and is still in this condition. That would be my suggestion for the board to consider.
I agree with you. I think that tabling is just, you know, it's a kind of a bittersweet recommendation in that it doesn't get us anywhere. At the same time, I would want to look for some legal advice. I'm interested in the town staff's inclination to step into the role to actually draw down the letter of credit, our actual right to do that, and if so, what can we do? What can the town do as far as improving the site to assure that this site is stabilized prior to frost, I mean, prior to this fall? We still, by tabling, we'll have a second week in August meeting where...
Third week in August.
Third week in August, I'm sorry. Meeting allowing plenty of construction time, if we should approve that. Or if we should choose to take action. You know, I twice bitten, I just feel like a fool if I were to vote for approval and the same thing happened all over again. I've never done that before. I've never shied away from it, but it's just happened too many times. I won't do it again. And I've got to have something more than just a little assurance to do that. And therefore, unless there's more discussion, I'll make a motion.
I just have one quick thing to say. Had you come before us this evening with a very positive attitude, such as we have new start dates, we have new stop dates, we're ready to go, this is it, I would have felt a little bit more comfortable. But even though it's been delayed, you still, there are no dates set and there's no completions and we're just kind of waddling out there in the ocean. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Edson. Okay. Mr. Wilcox, sorry.
I think that there was a consistent theme running through the public hearing at our last public hearing on this project, and that was clean it up and get it done. And I think we're doing a disservice to that effort by postponing a month. And I also feel that our planning board guidelines or ordinance, if you will, does not allow us to pull the bond. I would assume the bond would have been pulled by now, given the very obvious nature of this action, if it was deemed to be an issue. It's not something that's just kind of, you know, forgotten about and dragged on. I mean, this is something that's very noticeable that hit the press here in Town Hall, I'm sure, about a month ago. It seems like those questions have already been answered. And I see no harm in hearing those things repeated. Maybe I'm wrong, but I think that there's enough has been said about this project already that there aren't too many fresh angles that we will actually be able to effectively vote on.
Well, I guess if I'm not sure I understand you exactly about those questions that have already been answered. We certainly have had input from the public before. Mm-hmm. I think that's highly appropriate, and whenever we have something of this nature that is as much of a sore as it is, it seems to me that it's appropriate to try to get public input further on down the line. With respect to the answers about why the town has not pulled the letter of credit, I'm not sure that I've had an adequate answer to that. And I think it's important for the planning board to understand generally what the function of a letter of credit is. It's absolutely correct that we do not exercise the jurisdiction to make the decision, but as part of our ongoing administration of the ordinance, we regularly require letters of credit, and I think we need to understand what the town's policy is on them so that we better understand what we are asking for when we approve subdivisions. Now, that would be my interest in trying to understand how we've gotten to this point. Excuse me, would you like to say something?
Yes, I would, please. I'd like to once again address Mr. Carlson's concern over our inability to provide you with exact construction dates on the project. And basically, that's due to the fact that we did have to come before you again tonight. Our contractor was set to start in 2 weeks from the June 3rd meeting. However, he obviously has to go on to other projects now, and that's why we just can't provide you with an exact date until we know the outcome of this meeting. Once we do know the outcome, then we will, of course, contact our contractor and try to get him in there as quickly as possible.
Thank you.
Thank you. Further discussion from the board? Motion? Mr. Edson?
I have a motion for the board to consider. In order that based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the Highlands subdivision located in the vicinity of Jordan Farm Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channel View Road be tabled to the August 20th, 1996 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing should be held.
Do I hear a second to the motion? I'll second it. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion as stated, raise your right hand. All opposed? Thank you. 3-1. Thank you, Mr. Moore. And I would like to request that the letter of credit, the current letter of credit, be included in the package and that the town manager appear. Thank you.
Which is it?
The final item under new business is the Lawton public access waiver. Request by Norman Lawton for a public access waiver for a lot, FU 32, lot 5A, located off Columbus Road, section 19-4-2B, public access waiver. Give me a little background.
This lot is located off of Columbus Road, and one of the things that I did promise you this evening was a letter from the town attorney. I did get a letter. I did make copies for the board, but he has reviewed the subdivision issue and determined that there is no subdivision question here, that it's a legal non-conforming lot as of this date. The applicant has spent some time working on wetlands delineation and has come to the board tonight with a recommendation from the code officer that they need a public access waiver only. There's been a determination made that there is an RP1 wetland on the site, that it is under 2 acres, which would make it eligible for a 100-foot buffer, and so the applicant has designed a driveway that goes into the site, which is supposed to stay out of the 100-foot buffer area. But there are some issues that have been raised by the town engineer and by the fire chief regarding access into the lot and the adequacy of the turnaround. Any questions?
Mr. Chair, as I mentioned at the workshop, I'm a neighbor, actually received an abutter's notification. I just wanted to bring that up as a matter of clarification, as I did at the workshop. I don't certainly no conflict of interest. I don't sense any bias, as I did before. you know, if I sense, or any board member senses, you know, that I show any bias for any neighborhood constituency or whatever. So pretty much I will bring it up if I feel any coming on.
It's the consensus of the board that there is no problem. Thank you.
That's okay.
Can we hear from the applicant or the applicant's representative?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Tom Jewell. I represent Norman Lawton in this appeal. I'm an attorney from Portland, and we're here to ask for a public access waiver pursuant to your ordinance, section 19-4-2, paragraph B. In the process of submitting the application for the public access waiver, we were also asked to address the wetlands issue and setbacks from the wetlands in that area. We engaged the services of Owen Haskell to help us with a wetlands delineation map, and we're actually here on our third try, I guess third time's the charm. The first two were returned requesting additional information and some revisions as this fits within the town ordinance. After the second submission, we were asked if we would agree for the town to engage in independent wetlands analysis and critique by Albert Frick Associates, and we did consent to that, and they found that the results of Owen Haskell that we had submitted to the town were appropriate and met the town ordinance. As I understand, this is an RP1 wetland, which, because it is under 2 acres, results in a 100-foot buffer from the edge of that RP1 zone. I guess I should have brought a larger plan, but you all have a copy of the small one that we prepared. The 100-foot buffer is the dashed line. Shown kind of in the middle there is with an arrow delineating that. There's several lines. Some of those are boundaries of soil types, and the buffer line is that dashed line that goes through the property. As you can see, it butts up close or right against the existing driveway that serves the one house in that property, the Mindell residence. But the new road that would be built and a turnaround as designed for emergency vehicle access all are outside of that 100-foot buffer zone. The Lawtons owned the entire backland in 1992. They sold that adjoining lot to the Mindells, which includes that 50-foot strip that goes out the Columbus Road. In that deed, they reserved the right or access from the lot they retained to Columbus Road and the right to install utilities within that right-of-way. And they proposed to use that right-of-way to get to this property. Now, while the wetlands mapping was professionally conducted, I visited the site myself, and I guess I made the attempt to determine compliance with the specific criteria of the public access waiver under that 19-4-2B. I was proven wrong on at least a couple of accounts by the town engineer, and I apologize for that. I guess in part, we were focusing really on where the new construction was going to go in. The road or the driveway that serves the Mindell residence was just built sometime after 1992, and that lot was sold. And I guess I had assumed that it had been approved at that time and met the criteria. We are willing to make the changes that are needed to have that road comply with access for emergency vehicles, which seems to be the primary consideration that goes into this public access waiver. Larry Lydon has been helping Mr. Lawton with this appeal. He did visit the site with the town fire chief, and he also visited with the town public works director. I, in my package, did submit a short letter from the fire chief dated February 6, 1996. I noted in tonight's agenda on the old, or the, I guess from the minutes of June 18th, that there was an item on accepting a memorandum of the fire chief concerning the Lawton property. And I wasn't sure if that's the same letter that I submitted with my package from February, or if that's something different. Maureen, could you help me with that?
It's a memo written by the fire chief dated July 10th. I didn't realize you didn't have a copy. The drive coming off Columbus Road should be widened to permit fire apparatus approach. The grade should be checked as well. A turnaround should meet the town standards. An alternative to this might be to widen the present drive, change the approach to the property, with the proper radius, be able to back out into the present drive as a turnaround. And that's to me from the fire chief dated July 10th.
Thank you. The plan shows a turnaround entirely on the Lawton property. In part, that was because there was some uncertainty on whether we had a right ourselves, an illegal right, to use the Mintel driveway that was outside of that 50-foot wide right-of-way for the purposes of a turnaround. Our right is only to stay within that 50-foot wide corridor, so we showed a turnaround and our access entirely within that 50-foot corridor and the property that the Lawtons owned. So we were trying to just keep away from using the Mintel's driveway. Actually, an earlier plan that we had that Owen Haskell prepared did indicate a turnaround using the existing driveway that is into the Mintel property, but I thought that created some problems that we would rather avoid. As far as the other issues, I understand when Mr. Lydon did meet with Chief McGoldrick on the property and viewed that the improvements that they discussed in terms of widening that to an 18-foot wide travel way, I understand that the plan was to keep the present pavement, which is about 12 feet wide, as it was, and to add some gravel on either side, which might be grassed over, but provide a travel way for emergency vehicles that would be 18 feet wide, put the turnaround as we proposed in our plan, and get the grade and the radius on Columbus Road so it meets the requirements that are needed for the access. And we're willing to do all those things, and I apologize that in my letter, I guess I thought we complied with more of those than we did. I guess what I would suggest to the board is if they would be inclined to approve the public access waiver, that perhaps it would be on a condition that our final plans would be approved by the fire chief and make sure that they meet with his approval. I'm not going to belabor the specific criteria. I've gone through them on my application. Again, the town engineer has raised issues on a couple. It seemed to me most significantly was the grade on the beginning of that driveway where it butts up against Columbus Road. On my way here tonight, I stopped by and I said, geez, I didn't realize that first 10 feet was, it looks like it goes up a couple of feet from Columbus Road. And then after that, it's pretty level. It's possible that could be changed. Again, we certainly would plan to meet with our criteria. And whatever we do, I think it'll improve on the present situation, which apparently doesn't allow for any access for emergency vehicles to the existing residence that's there. Now, I know that the board received one letter from an abutter that Maureen sent me, and that one asked the board to postpone so that they could have further time to address some issues and mention particular wetlands. Again, wetlands, I believe, has been well addressed by two professional outfits that have good reputations that do that stuff and approved by the code enforcement officer. The other issues, the specific issue of the public access waiver, we will meet. And thank you for your consideration.
Thank you. Comments, questions?
Chair, I'd like to know what our policy is on granting public hearings on public access waivers. We do have a specific request here from an abutter, and I'm generally inclined to try to hear from the public if the public is, has expressed an interest, but I don't know exactly what our policy is.
About 4 years ago, the board held a public hearing on a public access waiver off of Old Ocean House Road. Following that, there were several amendments to the existing ordinance which give you official authority to hold a public hearing as an option. So you may schedule a public hearing under the ordinance. You may do it as part of a public access waiver.
And what has been our practice generally?
Generally, you don't do it unless there's been interest expressed by neighbors.
But where there has been interest expressed, I would take it that we normally do.
We can do it this evening if we wish.
No.
Comments, questions? Strumery?
I guess I was on another block when this came before the board previously. I remember the Mintels, but I don't remember the Lawtons or the specific issues related to this application. So in essence, it's all new and information, but I have a couple of comments that may be repetitive with the town engineers, and these comments were offered in light of the fact that at least the 11 by 17 or the smaller plan that we have was prepared by a wetland, I believe a soil scientist from Owen Haskell's office, on a plan that, although it refers to meets and bounds, does not have any certification for boundary survey, nor does it have any indication of elevations or topography, which I guess may be helpful, particularly with the layout of the road. And nor does it even list the name of the abutters. I assume that the Mintels own the lot to the west?
Yes.
Without frontage on Columbus Road?
Yes.
Are there abutters directly on Columbus Road?
Yes.
I can't tell.
No,
on either side of the right way.
Yes.
Right.
So these are two flag lots behind two existing lots. Are there any other lots associated with this two-lot subdivision, so to speak?
Not that is that right way.
But lots created by either the abutter or the applicant? I guess what I would suggest then is that I would support tabling this for another meeting and request that some sort of a context map be provided that shows a list of abutters and in the context, and if not total site survey, certainly something that puts it into the drainage context so that we can see where the water is flowing and all the rest of that, or at least have a record for our review.
I would accept that request.
Mr. Chair, a lot of the same concerns. I looked at this this plan, and while it represents it's to scale, I was trying to, I'm not an expert with a scale rule, but just the 100-foot setback, for instance, to scale is not 100 feet back from either the pond limit or the wetland upland edge, but I assume they're going from the pond limit. But the line that it represents, so according to my scale, is not 100 feet back. At least in a portion, and I was checking it at the point of the proposed driveway, which doesn't seem to fit. I guess the point is, I concur, I'd like to have an engineered plan that that has the required, or those items that we would request. I think an issue is, and a key issue for me, number one, the readability of the map and the reliability of the map. Number two, from that issue, it was unclear for me to look at this, who actually owned the right-of-way to the road, and it was not till tonight that you mentioned it. Tom, you mentioned that the Minetell lot doesn't have any frontage. I believe they have 50 feet of frontage by that.
As of the right-of-way.
Leg that comes out. It is always this issue that I deal with of how we grant rights, we grant approvals to interests, which I don't know that we have all the authority to grant those approvals. And I guess that's the issue of right, title, and interest. I'd like to see a copy of it, either the Minetell deed or whatever gives the applicant the right to travel on this and what the full bundle of rights are that Chuck...
Yeah, I'm sorry. I think I did misspeak. The Minetells own that right-of-way that goes up to Columbus Road, and the Lawtons reserved the right-of-way across...
I guess what troubles me with this application is that it appears from the engineer and some of the staff recommendation that significant improvements be made on property which other people own the fee, and then you do have a right-of-way, or the applicant has a right-of-way across there, but I always feel uneasy about the full interests that you have to do significant changes. In other words, cut into the slope, widen it to 18 feet. I'm not sure from our own town legal counsel whether they can give us that advice, whether we have the right to grant that authority or grant that approval. Otherwise, it makes sense that the fee owner comes as co-applicant to get that approval for public access waiver, if they should choose to do that. I guess those are, at this point in time, I also would favor, because we've had there was significant interest at the workshop and at least one letter here regarding public comment, that I'd recommend that we have a public hearing next month. That's it.
Go ahead.
I guess I've already spoken, but just to follow up on Steve's issue with the right-of-way, just enlighten me a little bit. This land has already been sold to the Lawtons. This parcel has been, our lot has been sold to the Lawtons by the Minetells?
No, it's the other way around, actually. The Lawtons own the entire parcel, and Lawtons sold the property to the Minetells in 1992. And in that deed, reserved the right of way across that 50-foot strip out to Columbus Road.
That's because in Mr. Minetell's letter, he refers to the Lawtons holding certain rights over the Minetell's property.
That's correct. That would be the right of way they reserved in that property when it was sold to the Minetells.
I guess even more reason to have a clear definition of whatever.
We can do that.
Ms. McKay?
I have a motion for the board to consider, especially in light of the time, which is 5 after 10, and that is, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Norman and Susan Lawton for a public access waiver for lot U-325A located on Columbus Road be tabled to the regular August 20, 1996 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing be scheduled.
Second. Any further discussion? Mr. Wilcox?
Is anybody interested in a site walk on this? It seems that apart from a highly detailed topographical analysis that where the driveway goes through the right-of-way, that the adjustment of the slope and whatnot in there might be a tricky bit of work that we could benefit by seeing the context in which it's actually located.
What does the board feel about a sidewalk? I mean, it's a single lot, although I was thinking to myself that I could probably drive by this and get out of the car and walk. I'm not so sure I even know where it is on Columbus Road. I'm sure I could find it, but it's not, we don't have a context map, as Mr. Emery asked for earlier.
I think it would be okay if board members just visited this driveway entrance here, if we could get some bearings, house numbers or whatever, to know where it is.
It seems it might be appropriate if we ask the person that owns the land if they mind if we drop it. Okay, if you don't mind if we drive in your driveway or something like that, Yeah, and you have no objection to us going over onto the Lawton property? I think we can do this on our own. The planning board seems to be pretty boxed in with a lot of meetings the upcoming 60 days, so one more is not necessary. Any other comments?
We do need some directions.
Some directions?
The Montell scale for that. Columbus Road is the second driveway on the left.
Oh, okay.
From Mitchell?
It would be the driveway between the first and second house on the left, right?
When you come down Columbus Road, the first house on the left is a blue split lot. The second house is a white split lot. There's a driveway in between those two houses, and that's the driveway.
So the neighbors won't call the police if a bunch of strange cars...
Can we turn around in the driveway, loop across the street, and lay on the horn before we leave?
I mean, I know where it is. If a board member wants me to go with them, we can do that, too.
I think we can all find it. Mr. Wilcox?
I have a question for Maureen. And Steve's question about the scaling of the setbacks was something that triggered it. Is there, in fact, a building setback from the RP2 line in addition to the no-cut, no-fill buffer zone from the RP1? Are the two necessarily the same, or are they, in fact, different?
No, there are two wetlands on this site, as far as I can tell from the map that's been submitted, and the issue that we were focusing on, because it's more restrictive, is the RP1. But there is also some RP2 wetland area on the site. And if someone were to include a building envelope within an RP2 wetland, then they would need a resource protection permit to build a house in an RP2 wetland. As long as you're not building in the RP2 wetland, then you don't need a wetlands permit. It has been the board's practice in the past, however, and you are allowed under ordinance to attach a buffer to an RP2 wetland. And in the past, you usually have looked at a buffer in the range of 10 to 25 feet, depending on the constraints of the site.
Thank you.
As further discussion, I guess I, for one, really would support a, I don't want to cause the applicant unnecessary duplication, but I do find this particular plan less than fully desirable, and I guess I would encourage the applicant to be more thorough in his next presentation.
Any other comments?
We have a motion, right? The motion has been seconded.
It has been seconded. All those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Unanimous.
Thank you.
Before we depart, we have an issue of a whether or not to have a workshop.
In August?
Meeting is adjourned. Now we've done that. It seems that we may need to have a workshop.
Do we have to vote to adjourn the meeting?
Excuse me?
We don't have to vote to adjourn the meeting?
No, he just declared.
Oh, okay.
Are we having a workshop?
It says right here. No workshop.
I thought the workshop was the Zork meeting.
We've got two. The problem is we've got two items. We've got the, you received a memo in tonight's packet regarding the ball fields for Fort Williams and Lions Field. I have with me tonight plans that have been submitted. And the board has two options. Either you can have a workshop to discuss this, or you can do it at a regular meeting, August 20th. Typically, when you first see a plan, you like to see it in a workshop session. So that seemed like that might be a better way to go. The other thing is there is an applicant out there who's looking to come in with a wetlands alteration permit, and it would probably be beneficial for them to come in for a workshop before they come in with their actual application. So I've been talking to the chair about, you know, these two items. You know, there's no real great way to do it. For August, you canceled your Tuesday meeting because you're having a Thursday meeting the same week to review the zoning ordinance. So either you can reinstall Tuesday meeting to deal with these two items, or alternately, you could try to deal with this after your August 20th meeting. We could adjourn from a regular meeting and go into a workshop.
What's the board's pleasure?
What's the, on the August the 20th, we've got Dominica's Crossing and we've got Lawton.
And the Highlands.
And the Highlands.
And probably another project.
Not going to be room to...
No, we don't want to do that.
Going to be late.
Well, let's just postpone this ballpark thing for...
The ballpark, the council has requested that you respond by September 1st.
But our workshop in September is September the 3rd.
Right.
So
and that date is probably going to be used for joint town council zoning review.
And everything.
But if that's the case, we could at least, we would be better off piggybacking a workshop on top of a ZORC meeting than we would on top of a planning board meeting.
Provided it gets out at 9 o'clock instead of 9:30.
Well, look at it, it's 10 after 10
or
here.
You could start an hour early. I mean, that's possible.
I don't think that's going to do any good. But.
No, finger shaking, sir.
We can do 15-minute
reviews. How long do we think the Fort Williams thing will take? I mean, I know you can't really predict, but...
I don't think...
Excuse me, is there anyone in the box back there? Can you shut off the cameras and the sound?
Are we off the air? Thank you.
Thanks.
Shut us all off, though. Shut us off here.
Just turn off the light, the on-air sign.